This is the BBC Home Service. Here is a police notice. A vanload of musical instruments was stolen this afternoon. It is believed to be having repercussions.
Fear not, dear unlicensed listeners. It will not stop the highly underpaid. Goon Show! You see? There are always foreign musicians who'll do the job. Thank you, Morris Winnick and his Scottish Highlanders.
Somebody called?
Silence, Colonel Nasser. Back to your harem at Highgate. Mr. Mouldy Greenslade, stop that disgusting habit and make your usual hash of the announcement.
Ladies and gentlepongalum, we give you a story specially rotten for the wireless type of radio sex.
Yes. A story entitled Dishonoured. It was written by Mrs. Bessie Braddock, better known for her work as Don Cockle. All parts will be played by human beings.
Well, good night, folks. Oh, Dishonoured, part one. The scene, the Limehouse waterfront. Enter a ragged idiot.
Alas, 'tis Christmas Eve, and still no offers to pantomime. Not a penny have I, not a penny towards a plate of vitals for me poor, weak, half-starved, 17-stone body. So I'll lay me poor 20-stone head down upon this bench.
Come along, you two, move along there now.
But Constable, 'tis the time of goodwill towards men, tis Christmas.
Truth, so it is. A merry Christmas to you, sir.
And a merry Christmas to you, Constable.
Right, now move along before I belt you around the ear.
A moment, please.
The voice came from a tall, dark, fully dressed male nude. He emerged from the darkness and walked into the gaslight.
Oh! Now then, Constable, how would you like to join the river, please?
Oh, very much, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Merry Christmas to you, sir.
Bon Noel!
Bon Noel.
Right. Now then, lad, I've come to help Voo.
He meant me. He glanced down at my feet, wrapped in coal sacks. My thrice-turned World War I overcoat. My brown paper shirt with the inked-in buttons. And my 6 months' growth of beard.
Down on your luck?
Whatever makes you think that, sir?
Your disguise didn't fool me.
It should do. It's genuine. But why should you be so interested in me?
I run a rag and bone shop.
You want a manager?
No, I want stock.
Well, I need a job.
You want to work?
Yes.
You must be desperate.
I held out as long as I could.
Well said. I have a very good friend, Hercules Grytpype-Thynne, and this is where the story really starts. This friend is in a bonk, or as you say in England, a bank. Now, how are you at mathematics?
I speak it like a native.
Splendid. You are the very type for the job. Dead stupid. Tomorrow, you start work at the Slippery Bank Limited.
We shook hands. He doffed his cap, and I acknowledged by raising my ex-RAF rubber dinghy. At last employment. My wife was overjoyed. Next day, I started work at the bank as a clerk, with every prospect of becoming a clerk. My wages were 8 shillings a week, with 3 shillings for each of my children.
This brought his money up to £80 a week.
That was the manager, Mr. Thynne, well known in concentric circles.
Mr. Seagoon, how long have you been with us?
20 minutes.
What a splendid record of devotion and honesty. Neddie, and this is where the story really starts. Neddie, I'm putting you in a position of trust. You're in charge of the gold vault. Here is the key.
Gold? Gold! Ah! Gold! Ah! I'll never be gold! I'll be rich! Gold! No more rags! Gold! Gold!
I wonder if he's the right man for the job.
I decided to pinch the gold.
Yes, this is the Charlie. I must tell friend Moriarty all is going according to plan.
Immediately, I backed a large horse-drawn motor van up to the front entrance of the bank.
You can't park that there, sir.
Constable, how would you like to join the river, please?
Very much, sir.
Merry Christmas. Carry on, Neddy.
Right. Next, I carefully disguised myself as a Zulu warrior of the Matabele Rising. So cunning was my makeup that even my own grandmother would have recognized me.
Hello, Neddy.
Hello, Granny. In this inconspicuous disguise, I took the gold from the vaults and loaded it onto the van. For 3 hours, I toiled back and forth.
Oh, Neddy.
Curses, I'm spotted.
Why are you wearing that leopard skin?
So that's why I'm spotted.
Neddy, where are you taking all that gold?
I shall have to think of a good excuse.
You're stealing it, aren't you?
Curse, why hadn't I thought of that? Yes. Yes, I'm stealing it.
I'm afraid we shall have to give you a week's notice.
Why? What have I done?
Oh, nothing, nothing. We're just having to cut down on the staff, you know. You see, there's been a robbery. Now get that van started while I get my hat and coat.
You coming too?
No point in staying here. There's more lolly in the van than there is in the bank.
Very well. We'll be partners.
Shake.
I give him my hand.
I gave him my foot. It was a fair swap.
Ying tong idlai po.
Good! Geldrey, take the wheel and drive us to Dishonoured Part 2.
Huzzah!
Dishonored Part 2, and this is where the story really starts. With their newfound wealth, Ned Seagoon with Grytpype-Thynne and Moriarty paint the town red. Then, one day, as Seagoon was in the bath, the first blow fell.
Oh, Neddy, Neddy, get out of that dustbin. Bad news. The bank you stole the gold from told the police.
What a rotten trick. There's nothing sacred.
Give yourself up, Neddy.
Give myself up?
Yes, the police want you, lad.
Nonsense, I'm much too short for the police.
Then you'll have to go abroad, the Mediterranean.
Very well, we sail at dawn. Tonight! Within a week, we were on board a private yacht sailing west, northwest, south. I stood on the pilchard with a spanker blowing through my hair. And the salty bloaters spinning before the giblets. It's a man's life, I tell you. A man's life, I tell you.
You silly, twisted boy.
Hello, Captain Thynne. What's our position?
Desperate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.